Morning, Mark. Right. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well. How are you, Joe?
I'm doing fantastic.
All right. So I'm going to quiz you. I've given presentations. You've seen a couple of them. And I usually go over the exact same thing in every one. And that is the four pillars that add value to any internet business. So were you paying attention or were you on your phone dealing with some sort of deal?
Well, it's a great question. I don't know if I'd reiterate them in the same order that you do, but generally speaking, people look at the risk of a business, which comes with age, absolutely the transferability of a business. You know, if you can't fully transfer all of the business so that the revenue is going to continue, then the value is not the same. I always look at growth opportunities. Buyers love those. They can step into paths of growth. That's really, really key. And the last one being the thing that is the easiest thing within somebody's control, and that's, I call it good, clean financials. I think you call it documentation, right? How'd I do?
You would have passed the test.
And all right.
Hopefully everyone else pays as much attention as you did, or at least are as smart as you are. You know, the documentation part, I mean, that you're right. That is completely under people's control. And it encompasses more than just the financials. In my opinion, it deals with standard operating procedures and the contracts that you have in your business. But the financial portion is the lion's share of that pillar, right? If you don't have good, clean financial documents for your business, it's going to either hurt the price completely or it's going to make it unsellable. I've been dealing with one woman. I've been helping one woman for probably 3 years now. And she's got a nice little e-commerce business and she wants to sell it. But every time I ask for the documentation, we don't know what her inventory numbers are because it's really hard for her to calculate them. And I keep telling her, do the work. It's going to add a lot of value to the business. And every time she says, I'm not sure if I want to do that. People don't take care of their documentation on a repeat basis. I know you've seen that as well.
Yeah. You've got to track your inventory. The easiest place to hide something is in cost of goods sold. I've done valuations for businesses that do $20 million in revenue, but they don't use QuickBooks or Xero. They use Excel. Excel is not accounting software. You got to have good financials. If somebody's going to stroke a check for their life savings, more or less, whether it's $50, $100, $1 million, it doesn't matter. It's they've worked very hard for that money and they want to have confidence that the books are good. And I'm not talking about not writing off things that entrepreneurs write off, whether it's meals and entertainment, personal travel, whatever it might be, all that, you know, we get it. Entrepreneurs do that, but it's tracking it properly. It's tracking the income and the expenses and not commingling with another business and things of that nature. You've got to have good, clean financials in order to get maximum value for your business. I'm not talking about being able to sell your business. I've sold businesses where literally somebody's used a credit card and a bank statement for 10 years. We had to go back and build a P&L, or he did, for at least 3 years, which is a lot more work than hiring a bookkeeper for a few hundred dollars a month to do it on a monthly basis going forward. But we still managed to sell that business, albeit probably not for the maximum value it could have been sold for if he had started 10 years ago using Xero or QuickBooks.
You know, I think what's fascinating is in the online world, we're very data-driven. You know, articles that are data-driven are proven to bring more readers. And everyone knows in the SaaS world, you need to have your data. But the one piece of data so many of us lack is the financials. And that's a really, that might be the most important data point for your company overall. You know, when I first graduated from college, I worked for an internet firm. Out in Baltimore, Maryland, we were selling web hosting and servers and stuff like that. And the dot-com boom happened in 2001. And I remember surviving massive layoffs. 27 out of the 30 people in my department got laid off. I was one of the people that did not. And I remember asking the CEO of the company what our cost was for the servers versus how much we were actually bringing in revenue. And none of the executive team could answer the question. And I thought that was so crazy at the time. But now, you know, 10 years, not 10 years later, many years later, 17 years later, I see that as a problem ongoing. So why do you think people don't keep track of their financials very well?
it's not their area of expertise. Look, entrepreneurs, for the most part, the majority of them are great at taking an idea from inception all the way through to actually, you know, providing revenue and for the business. It's that little minutia in detail that is not as exciting for some as it is for others. And it's, you just get a ballpark idea of the numbers and you start out that way in many cases. I know I did when I launched my e-commerce business, or my business in general prior to e-commerce. And then you just never really quite catch up. I started liking accounting when my brother's best friend, who's a CPA, came over to help me out, help me with reconciling my accounts. I'd never done it before. I didn't want to hire somebody to do it. I figured I could do it myself. And this is using Quicken. It wasn't even QuickBooks. It was Quicken back in 1997. Sat out on the back porch, had the laptop, couple of beers in hand, and he found $25,000 that I didn't realize I actually had. I started liking accounting right then and there. Now listen, the person that we're going to interview here in this podcast, his name is Matt Ramuzzi, and he's from CapForge. I found him, or he found me actually, Mark, by looking at a number of businesses that we've presented online, and occasionally he pokes holes in the numbers. And I liked it, because he pointed out some interesting things and I was learning from him. And I've referred a few clients over to him that needed their books done. And every single one of them has come back to me with glowing recommendations and really, really good, clean financials that, again, will bring maximum value. There's two things that we touch on in here. One is a little bit of sales taxes and his opinion on it. That's the second, but more importantly, is one that a lot of people don't even understand or like to talk about, which is cash accounting versus accrual accounting. And you and I both know in an e-commerce business where there's physical products, it's huge to use accrual accounting, because when you do the valuation, it brings the value up tremendously. It's the right way to do it. And I've sold businesses that other brokers had quoted it and it was cash, and I brought the numbers to accrual and it brought the value up by $250,000. You've heard me tell that story before. So with that, let's get to it. Let's do the interview with Matt Ramuzzi from CapForge. Hey Matt, welcome to the Quiet Light Podcast.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Fantastic to have you here. Instead of me doing it, why don't we give the audience a little bit of background on yourself? Can you tell us about your world of bookkeeping and how exciting it is?
It's very exciting. Yeah. You know, I understand. I know where our place is in the world, but it's something I've been doing for a number of years. I have a background in it. I have also have an MBA. I've been an entrepreneur myself. So, you know, it's something I understand the importance of, and I know a lot of small business owners kind of put it on the back burner, but it's not just something you need to do for tax time. There's a lot of other advantages to it too. Primarily, accounting and bookkeeping is an information system. It helps you know where your business is at, what the top line is, what your expenses are, and what's driving or holding back your bottom line. So I always encourage people to get to know the numbers of your business and know them on a regular basis, because things you track and measure, you tend to be able to improve. Things you're not tracking and measuring often fall by the wayside, or you just, sometimes you get lucky, sometimes you don't, but you kind of never know where you're at, and you're always just putting out fires day to day. So bookkeeping gives you, and accounting gives you, that insight into your business that you're not going to get from a lot of other sources. So that's why I think it's super important. And I think a lot of people, once they see it, they kind of get hooked on it.
Yeah, I agree. I told the story in the intro how I got hooked on it, so I won't tell again. But you know, I think that when you combine knowing where you are in your business, like you said, you got to know where you're at. When you combine that with understanding the valuation process, you can look at where you are, you can calculate your own discretionary earnings, and then, you know, calculate the own your own value of the business. When I have clients come to me with no financials, no P&L, they use Excel spreadsheets. It's tough. It's tough to update them. You cannot run a balance sheet. You cannot do a lot of things with Excel that you can do with accounting software. So tell us about your typical client. Who do you work with? I'm assuming as we've referred people to you, it's a lot of internet entrepreneurs that you work with, right?
For sure. We've got a whole range of people with online businesses. We have a lot of Amazon FBA sellers who are doing private label stuff or moving into their own product lines. We have a lot of multi-channel sellers who are not only on Amazon, but also doing things on eBay or out of their own Shopify stores. We even have a couple of software as a service businesses. Each one we look at and kind of understand exactly what their specific needs are. Somebody doing Amazon retail arbitrage, for example, is a different animal than somebody who's doing private label, just because everything they buy is sort of a one-off cost of goods sold, versus somebody who's doing private label and may only have two or three SKUs when they start. But we'll look at each project. We'll kind of customize what we're going to do for their specific needs. And then we'll take all the data in and put it into an accounting platform. We typically use QuickBooks. And the advantage of that, as you just said, is if somebody's going to look at it down the road, whether it be the IRS, an investor, a lender, or a potential acquirer, what they can do is tie everything back. So there's numbers on a bank statement that show up in QuickBooks. There's numbers on a credit card statement or for invoices from suppliers and so on. Everything can be tied back and proved and demonstrated. And somebody looking at that can say, yes, these are legitimate numbers. I'm willing to invest on this basis or lend on this basis or buy on this basis. When you've got things in Excel, you can put anything in any Excel cell and there's no backup. There's no necessarily way to tie that back. And so people just don't have the same level of confidence that those numbers are accurate and legitimate. And so I think to your point about, running the business right, you really need to have it in proper accounting format. And that's what we do for our clients, is set it up correctly and then maintain it on an ongoing basis.
What's involved in the setup process? What do you need access to? How do you start with a client that has been running their business successfully for years? Let's say they started it up like many do. They give it a shot and they don't want to invest in a new LLC and they don't want to invest in separate bank accounts and QuickBooks software, but they just give it a go. And 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months in, they realize they've got a viable business. What would you do for them at that point to bring them, into the proper accounting process?
So we always start with, when did the business start? Because even if you were using personal funds, a personal credit card, we want to make sure you capture those expenses and get credit for them because they were part of the business process. But we typically start the official counting from whenever, if you've got an LLC or an S corp, we'll start it from the day that started using that bank account. The previous expenses and income will be put in as contributions and so on and set that up. But we want to give everybody credit for everything they put into the business. So again, it's kind of case by case on how we do it. But what we normally work from are bank statements and credit card statements and access to an Amazon seller account if they're an Amazon seller, or a Shopify account, or eBay or PayPal accounts, depending on what they're using and what they've got going. But we want to work from the source materials. What we don't want is, don't FedEx us a big envelope of receipts. That's not, keep those for your own records. But what we're going to work from are the statements. We want beginning balances, all the transactions, ending balances. We're going to reconcile everything. And again, make sure that that audit trail is there. So if you're claiming certain expenses, we can go back and point to exactly where they happened in your transaction list. And we always, we've got, at this point, we've done it enough times that we have instruction sheets that we send to a client. So here's how to get what we need from your bank or from your credit card or from Amazon. And we make it super simple. I've even started recording some videos so I can just email a person a link to a video. Here's how to do it. And we make it as easy as possible. So it literally can take somebody 10 or 15 minutes to get us everything we need to get started. And then from there, we pretty much take over and they can be hands off. And we're just giving them what they need on an ongoing basis.
How hands off? Do they need to log in on a daily, weekly, monthly basis, or do you do all the accounting work for them?
We can do 100% of the bookkeeping work for them without them having to get involved. So, and that's what I tell people, your time is better spent growing your business, managing the things that I can't do for you, whether that's, researching and picking new products to add to your product line, or managing your employees, or whatever it is. Those are things I can't do for you. But what I can do is take this admin task off your plate, and not only take the time off, but this way you're getting it done by professionals who know how to do it, rather than trying to learn it yourself and making potentially expensive mistakes and trying to figure it out on your own.
And having good, clean books will definitely bring more value. I see it over and over again. Let me ask you a question from a bookkeeping standpoint. I get P&Ls presented to me. Let's say it's they're selling on Amazon, for instance. Is the right way, maybe there's two right ways, maybe there's no wrong way, but what's the right way to log the income from Amazon? I see some people do it after Amazon takes out their fee, so they only report the deposits, or should they do the total revenue minus the Amazon fees, minus the fulfillment, all of those different things? What's the right way?
So the right way is definitely to log the top line that Amazon gives you. Then the reason for that is simple. Amazon's going to send to the IRS a statement that says, this is the total amount of sales that we recorded on your behalf. If all you're recording is deposits after their fees, you're going to have a sales number you're going to hand to your tax preparer that's going to be significantly understated from what Amazon's going to report to the IRS. And now you're going to have a problem because the IRS is going to say, hey, Amazon said you have 400,000 in sales, but you're only claiming 250 or whatever the number is. So we always set it up such that the top line, the total sales, is the first number we show. Then we take out all the Amazon fees and then go from there. And that way, at the end of the year, our financial statements match exactly what Amazon has reported. Not only that, but we also record if in a given month you have 50,000 in sales per Amazon, that's not what they deposit because they only pay on a biweekly basis. And so some of that 50,000 is actually going to hit the next month. And you want to make sure you've recorded that as well. So on an accrual basis, we show your sales for the month, offset that with your actual COGS. In the following month, we'll show the actual deposits coming in on a cash basis. So we're keeping track of it both ways, which is how you want to see it. You want to know what your cash is, but you also want to know what your total sales are.
I think when you mention accrual and a cash, people just, you know, their eyes roll back. It's critical though. It's critical. And I've seen it bring, you know, value to the tune of $250,000 on listings that I've had before. But I want to touch on the fact that your 1099 won't match if all you record are the deposits, because if the business is big enough, if it's aged enough, if it's, you know, 3 years of tax returns, then it's possible that your buyer could be doing a purchase with an SBA loan. And the SBA, the lender, Wells Fargo, Bank United, whoever it might be, they're going to require 3 years of tax returns.
Yes.
And when that underwriter gets the tax returns and it has a certain number on it, and it doesn't match the P&Ls, they're going to start asking questions as to why. And it just makes things more difficult. The third-party valuation company, they're going to do the same thing. And the cleaner the books are, the better. That's the ongoing message here. So you just said the word accrual and cash accounting. Give us a definition. Right.
Sorry, and I try not to get too deep in the weeds. And I promise when people call, you know, we always start out in plain English. And if they want to go into accounting stuff, we can. But otherwise, we try and keep it high level and straightforward. But
let me interject that I really want people to listen to this because I'm going to tell a story where I found $250,000 just by flipping to accrual in value of business. Go ahead.
Right. So the idea is on a cash basis, that's basically just doing your accounting by looking at what's in the bank. If you have a deposit in the bank at a certain time, it counts as income. If you have money coming out of the bank at a certain time, you're counting that as expenses. Accrual is sort of the big boy pants level of accounting where you're not looking at just when the cash came in. You're looking at when the sale actually was recorded or when the cost was actually recorded. So Amazon is going to tell you for a certain month that you made $50,000 in sales. That doesn't mean $50,000 came into your account that month. It means that $50,000 worth of sales was recorded in that time period. Likewise, they shipped out for you those products and we record the expense for those products, even if in reality, you bought that inventory months ago. So the point of accrual accounting is to try and match up the time of the sales with the time of the expenses. Cash basis just says, hey, whenever it happened, that's when we'll write it down. So cash basis isn't wrong. It's just a more simplified way of doing things, and it only is looking at your actual bank balance. Accrual accounting is really trying to record when things happen and match up your sales and expenses, which is a really helpful way to look at your business because that's when things are actually happening, even if that's not when the expenses came in or went out of the bank.
When we present a listing for sale, we do it on an accrual basis. Mm-hmm. So for all those people out there buying businesses, if you find a broker, this is the way you get that golden nugget. If you find a broker that lists a business for sale, and it's let's say it's an Amazon business, or they're selling off that platform as well. If it's growing month over month, year over year, and the owner's just taking all that money and putting it back into inventory, trying to keep up with growth, and they've got the financials presented on a cash basis, and the broker values the business based upon that cash basis, buy it. Yeah. And then come to me, and we'll do it on accrual. And there's a much, much bigger value there. Yes. So to make this real quickly, you will do all of this for the entrepreneur, right?
100%. They don't have to know cash versus accrual. They don't have to make a decision which way they want us to do it. We'll do it all properly and correctly. And if they want to see it on a cash basis, we can show them that report. If they want to see it on an accrual basis, we'll show them that report. That's, you know, and I'll walk through with them. Here's what these numbers mean. Here's how you should look at it and interpret it and give them some education on this. But we will take care of all that. They don't have to learn or know about any of this stuff. We'll help them with that.
Okay. Real quick story before we move off of this subject. I had a listing come to me. It was a couple in New Zealand. And they had been shopping around for a broker. And they came to me with a business. It was only 18 months old. And it was growing like crazy. They had a beautiful brand. It was 100% Amazon. Really, really nice business. And because it was growing so much, they were constantly putting money back in inventory. They were not pulling a whole lot out. Right. And they gave me the financials presented on a cash basis. And they had already shopped around. And they said, this is what we'd like to get for the business. Not what I really want to hear. I want to determine the value of the business, not have a seller tell me. I tell every buyer I work with, I don't ask. I don't want to know, because I always want to be honest with the buyer as well. But I took their financials and worked with them on that old accrual accounting formula and flipped the P&L to accrual. And the value of the business, just by going from cash to accrual, rose by about $250,000. That's how much they were growing. That's how much money they were putting back in inventory. And we were able to bump the value of the business, lower the multiple a little bit over what everybody else was doing, and still achieve their goals, which was to sell the business within a certain amount of time, because they had a house under contract contingent upon the sale of a home, which is contingent on the sale of a business, which is a crazy, crazy story and not the right thing to do. Right. Let's talk about one other awful subject, if you can stomach it, and that's tax returns. I mean, sales taxes. And collecting them. What's your take on it? What do you recommend for entrepreneurs, for business owners? I know you're not, you know, you're a semi-expert in this particular space, but I heard you on another podcast where you had some really good advice. What are your thoughts on this, and when should people start collecting?
Right. So this is a question that comes up all the time, and there's different people out there with different opinions. And my first comment to people is, you have to go with what you're comfortable with. Certain people have a very low tolerance for risk, and they want to go to the extreme of trying to be compliant. And other people, either through ignorance or through an aggressiveness, go the other extreme and you know, pay nothing and avoid all taxes until somebody comes after them or sends them a letter. My advice to clients is, go with wherever your home state is. So assuming you're in the US, whatever your home state is, where you actually live and conduct business, if you register and pay sales tax in your home state, that's probably the safest bet, because wherever you live, you probably also, you know, register a car at the DMV, you may own property there, you've got a lot of ways for them to come after you. If for some reason you turned up in an audit that you had this business, that you were making sales and you potentially owed sales tax. But outside of that, until you really get to be a good size, and I'm talking 7 figures plus annual sales, it's really difficult to pay, to make the argument that all the cost of compliance of paying sales tax in all those other states makes sense. I mean, I can tell you literally, I've seen many, many clients where the cost of compliance was 10 times what they were paying in sales tax. I mean, their sales tax bill may have been $4 or $5 because, you know, they had a nexus in Kentucky or something and they had a few bucks of sales there, but they were paying literally $200 or $300 a quarter to stay compliant in Kentucky to pay a $5 sales tax bill.
And those people in Kentucky aren't going to spend a whole lot of time or money to go after that person for $4 or $5 in sales.
If they even found out, I mean, even if I called Kentucky Department of Revenue and said, hey, I happen to know for sure that there's a guy selling through Amazon and he owes you $8. There's nothing they're going to do about it. They're not going to put a guy in a plane and fly him out to California or wherever you're actually located and try and collect the $8. It just doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
So, you know, I know there's companies out there whose whole business model is to get you to believe that you need to sign up in all the possible states and start paying a monthly fee to them and they'll register you and they'll, you know, remit your sales tax and everything. But my personal opinion is that is not a good use of funds, especially when you're smaller and especially when the amounts you could potentially be remitting are in the single digits. So your home state is one thing because there are some possible repercussions there. They do have some leverage. And just the history of sales tax law sort of implies that you really do owe that sales tax. But the other 49 states, wherever you're not located, I would personally let those go until much farther down the road.
Till you get a little bigger, right? Yeah. Well, it's still a gray area and it's always great to hear different people's opinions on it. Let's talk a little bit about write-offs. As entrepreneurs, we see all sorts of different things that people mm-hmm. write off. And some, you know, bookkeepers and CPAs are comfortable with certain level of write-offs. If someone's going to use your services, what are you comfortable with? What do you suggest they do and don't write off? How do you work with them on that?
I always tell them, just as a general rule, if you're only buying something because of your business, then that's a pretty fair bet that that should be a legitimate deduction. So a lot of people sort of overlook things like, you know, a lot of times you're using your cell phone, you're using the internet, you're using different things, services you're paying for that you may have been paying for before you started the business, but now you're using it for the business or at least partially for the business. And those are all fair game for being taken into consideration. What I warn people about, and everybody, again, has to make their own decisions. Some people want to be more aggressive. Some people want to be real conservative. What triggers problems is when you're significantly outside the norms for your business. So if you're running an online business, it's fair to say that meals and entertainment is probably not a big piece of what you do. You're not dining clients out because, you know, they're buying from you from online. And so you're not meeting in person. You're not probably doing a lot of meals and entertainment. So if your meals and entertainment number is 10% of your total sales, that's probably a problem. Or if you're writing off, you know, 4 or 5 vehicles for what's effectively an online business where you're shipping straight to Amazon, you probably don't legitimately, you know, that's a hard to swallow number for an auto expense. But we'll try and go through every client and say, you know, is there anything we're forgetting? Did you do any marketing you're forgetting about? Or do you have any subscriptions on maybe a personal card you haven't transferred over yet? You've got a, you know, a Jungle Scout subscription on a personal card. We need to make sure that gets included in the business, that kind of stuff. Or, you know, did you include your cell phone? Did you buy insurance? Did you take any trips to industry events? All that kind of stuff. We'll quiz them to try and make sure we've captured everything we can legitimately capture. And at the same time, if they start saying, oh, well, what about my student loan? What about this and that that doesn't apply? We'll likewise kind of warn them that, you know, these aren't things that should be included. We'll capture everything we can, but we don't want to cross any lines and create any red flags. You know, at that point, if they insist, or that sometimes people will tell me, well, my CPA said I could do it. All right, you know, we'll put it in if they're willing to sign off on that. But we try and keep people as we get them the maximum amount of write-offs they can get without crossing any lines that are really going to get them in trouble.
A lot of the folks that I work with work from a home office. Can they write off their home office, or is that a red flag, so to speak?
A home office deduction is perfectly legitimate. Whether you're a sole proprietor, then for sure, if you're a corporation, but that's your only location, then that's also completely legitimate. If you're a corporation or an LLC and you have an outside office, then also taking the home office deduction has a little bit more of a restriction on it. But most people are still working from home, at least until they get to a pretty good size.
Okay. Well, in terms of size, tell us about the size of your average client and what kind of clients you like to take on. And then what kind of costs are associated with your services?
Sure. So, I mean, we take on everybody from the very, very startups, people who just literally dropped their first pallet at Amazon, all the way up to people who are, you know, 7 figures plus annual sales. So I love to work with people who are just starting out because I know we're getting them started out on the right foot as opposed to somebody who's been in business for a few years. And like you said, hey, I just have a bunch of Excel sheets and a box full of receipts. So that's, we can certainly take those on too, but it's, you know, we have to do some backtracking. But really any size is fine with us. You know, we've got our system down pretty well that we are efficient and can do it sort of regardless of the client's size or needs. As in terms of fees, you know, for the real small startup guys, we're starting at about $100 a month. And for people cheap. We can do it quickly because we've got our system down. So we're sort of passing the savings on and we're looking to grow with our clients. When they get up into the, you know, mid six figures, then it's more like $300 a month, and into seven figures, you know, you may be $350, $400 a month.
But still, that's a full-time bookkeeper for less than $5,000 a month or $1,200 a month if you're just starting. That's incredible.
For sure. Yeah, I think it's a great investment. I think, wow, you know, you're foolish to do it on your own or to try and find somebody local, you know, off Craigslist or something who's $20 an hour but has never even heard of Amazon. You're going to get what you pay for in that case.
Do your clients have access to their own books? Can they log in and run a P&L report? Can they look at it anytime they want to and have access to it?
100%. We do all of our clients on QuickBooks Online. So it's cloud-based accounting. They actually, we sign up and pay for it because we get a wholesale rate, but they own the account. So if at any point they want to log in, they want to give their CPA access, or even if they want to take the books over themselves and, you know, leave us, they own that data. They own that account. They're free to move at any point. All of our contracts are month to month. So we don't lock anybody in. We want them to keep coming back every month because they love our service and they can't find a better deal. But if you do want to go for whatever reason, we don't hold your books hostage. We don't hold your data hostage or charge a cancellation fee. That's your data. You paid us to put it in, but after that, you own it. So yeah, anybody can get in at any time. And some people like to really get in and run a ton of reports. Other people are just sort of happy with the ones we send once a month. Everyone's kind of different on that.
That's a pretty incredible peace of mind to know that all the financials are done. You, as an entrepreneur, you don't have to touch them. You just get up in the morning and you log in and it's magically there. That's a beautiful thing. I wish every client I work with kind of did that.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, that's what we're selling is the peace of mind. And I hear so often from people, you know, once we've kind of gotten in and taken over and helped them out, they go, you know, this is a load off my shoulders because I knew it had to get done. I didn't really know how to do it. I didn't really want to dive in. I hate this stuff. I'm so glad I found you guys. You just took care of all of it and I don't have to worry about it anymore. And honestly, if I could fit all that into a nice AdWords ad, you know, we'd have a million clients, but, yeah, that's what we do, is it's peace of mind and knowing not just that it's done, but it's done by somebody who knows what they're doing, who's done a ton of these before and takes a professional approach to it. You know, not just somebody that's, you know, somebody's friend or cousin or something who took a QuickBooks class. Because it's really easy to screw this stuff up if you don't know what you're doing. Or like you said, you run it all on a cash basis because you don't know any better and you destroy the value in the business.
Right, right. And it makes it more difficult if and when you do go to sell the business to get a good valuation, right, from an experienced broker. I got to tell you, I've referred a few people to you, as you know, and I just keep hearing more and more positive things. So I think it's a great service. I want to trademark the term, what is it, the slogan, Excel is not accounting software. Can I do that? Can I use the word Excel? And make people, force people to go and use a good qualified bookkeeper, because it's that peace of mind and the cost associated with it is nothing compared to hiring somebody local to do your books for you on an hourly or weekly basis. I mean, it's just incredible service. So listen, I appreciate you having you on. How do people learn about you? How do they find you? How do they get in touch with you?
So the best way to find us is just go to the website. It's capforge.com. If you're specifically an online or Amazon seller, go to capforge.com/Amazon. That's our page that kind of details all the Amazon services, online business services we do. And easiest thing is just if either send me an email, the info@capforge.com email, or give us a call. I'm happy to chat with anybody, kind of run through what we can do. Tell me about your specific situation. I'll give you the details and the information, and I'll give you a quote, you know, specific to your situation. And if you're interested, you know, we can jump right on it. I've got a full-time staff here, and, you know, I'd love to build our Amazon and online business you know, as big as we can go. So, you know, by all means, give us a call.
Excellent. Thanks for being on the show, Matt. I appreciate it.